Welcome, everyone, to the I2B2 Transmart Foundation training program. Today, we will have our October training class. We're delighted to welcome Elena Fedorovich, who has done quite a few trainings for us already from Rancho Bioscience, who will be giving the webinar on the use of Transmart platform with complex clinical data sets. In particular, we're excited to have our first presentation where they'll be using the data from the Michael J. Fox Foundation, and she will describe this in a lot more detail in a minute. Just remind you that we do have a probe training every month. This is the October version. We still have two classes left this year, one in November, using the R interface for crust study analysis, contributed by the Clarivate analytics group. And in December, Rancho will be giving another class on Transmart advanced training. Earlier this year, we've had a number of other webinars that have been recorded and available on our training site, including classes by the Hive. And we want to give a big thank you to our three contributors, Rancho Bioscience, Clarivate Analytics, and the Hive, for donating their time for producing these classes for us. Just a little bit logistics. I will monitor the class today. If you have a question, you have three ways you can get my attention and ask a question. You can raise your hand on your dashboard. You can type in a question in the question window, and you can also ask post something to the chat window. And again, I will monitor these. And if you have a question or something comes up, please let me know. Just going to take another 2 minutes here to just talk a little bit about the foundation. The foundation's vision is to realize the promise of precision medicine. We were brought together earlier this year, the I2B2 Foundation and the Transmart Foundation, into the current I2B2 Transmart Foundation. The foundation, the mission is to improve outcomes and bring together closer together the healthcare and translational research teams, using the two platforms that we have today, the Transmart platform and the I2B2 platform. And we're dedicated to open source software, open data where it's possible, and ultimately getting towards open science. We have a number of activities that you should be aware of. We have a monthly community meeting where we have guest speakers. We talk about the foundation's platforms and other topics of interest. We have this monthly training class. We also offer a newsletter monthly, and also have a website that we keep up to date, as well as our social media program. Our news blast just gives you some quick pointers to what's going on for that particular month. You can sign up from the website, and also when this slide deck will be available, and you'll be able to use the links there. We also have an active social media program. Again, you can reach out either on these, either through Facebook or Twitter or LinkedIn. We have a YouTube channel and Google+. Please follow us there, and we try to keep our news and topics of interest. A couple weeks ago, there was a I2B2 conference in Paris that brought together 150 people, largely from the in Central Europe, and talked about I2B2, but also we had a couple of sessions that included Transmart. Also, Sean Murphy and Paul Viak were keynote speakers and talked about I2B2, Transmart, and also our projects to bring these two platforms together. And then next week at the AMIA conference, we will have an evening program on November 6th. So if you're going to AMIA, please stop by and say hello. And for 2018, we have a number of activities that we're working on for the year. I call in particular a precision medicine meeting at Harvard. This will be our third time. We'll be joining the group there from TBMI, who runs a precision medicine meeting. And following that meeting, we'll have 2 days of a user meeting for I2B2 Transmart. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Elena to present her program. And we'll get started. Again, if you have any questions, please please feel free to raise your hand or one of the other methods. Thank you. And Alana, I should have just made you presenter.
Okay, let me share my screen. So do you see my screen now?
Not yet. You have to accept. I invited you to present.
Yes, I did.
There you go. Got it.
Okay. Thank you, Rudy, for the introduction. Welcome, everyone. Today we have Transmart training using complex clinical data sets, as Rudy already said. So we'll start with brief background information about Transmart, go through Michael J. Fox Foundation initiative, PPMI and BioFind clinical datasets overview and access to them, and then we'll proceed to demonstration where we're going to explore some major functionalities and new capabilities of Transmart version 16.2 in the analysis of clinical data from PPMI and BioFind. Transmart is an open source community-driven data management system for translational medicine. The Transmart platform version 1 was released under GPL license by Johnson & Johnson in 2012. A year later, the Transmart Foundation was incorporated as a public-private partnership. The latest Transmart version 16.2, which was released last year, contains SmartR, subsetting on omics data, Ingenuity IPA pathway analysis connector, Genome Browser and MetaCore plugins are returned. It contains XNet imaging platform interface, GivaSplint integration and results enhancements, and ETL improvements. Additional information about the platform, training materials, webinars, and more could be found on the Transmart Foundation website. At the top, you see the link to the Transmart Foundation webpage, user guides, where you can find useful information on Transmart 16.2 documentation and very useful Transmart version 1.2 user guide for Transmart users. Transmart allows molecular data and clinical data to work together, joined by a unique subject's IDs. To integrate data into platform, a good collaboration between scientists, clinicians, developers, service providers, and ETL engineers is crucial. And the result of such collaboration you will see today. Michael J. Fox Foundation is creating a data curation program to make the field of Parkinson's disease research more efficient and expedient. MGFF wants to provide researchers with cost savings and help to avoid duplication of efforts in the competitive space. Results of this initiative will be clean, analyzable, high quality data sets with access to a Transmart instance, download Transmart ready files and files curated for SAS format. Data sets will be curated and loaded into Transmart periodically, starting with PPMI and BioFind, which are already available, followed by LARC2, Fox Insight, and other studies. Rancho Biosciences is implementing a solution to integrate data sets with different complexity from different sources using continuous data integration and curation to common standards across all studies. The studies on MGFF are publicly available, but you have to register for access to an MGFF Data Access Center. Raw data and curated data in Transmart can be accessed through NeraShare on Michael J. Fox Foundation. After clicking the link above, click Create Account, enter the requested account information, and click Register. Note that you will only need to register for access to the MGFF Data Access Center once. Creating an account will allow you to see if additional data sets become available through the Data Access Center. You will also have to get access in Loni and request access to datasets. to be able to use Transmart. Once you get your access and put your credentials, please use Chrome and Mozilla browsers for better Transmart performance. You will open the data access portal on NeraShare, and here you see two studies available where you can load raw data from Loni, curated data in CSV format and text format, and this data is loaded in Transmart, and have access to Transmart clicking on each any of these two buttons. The portal also have questions. PPMI is the Parkinson Progression Markers Initiative, which is a landmark observational clinical study to comprehensively evaluate cohorts of significant interest using advanced imaging, biologic sampling, and clinical and behavioral assessments to identify biomarkers of Parkinson's disease progression. It is an ongoing study taking place in the United States, Europe, Israel, and Australia. BioFind is an observational clinical study designed to discover and verify biomarkers of Parkinson's disease. This study was carried out at 8 academic sites in the United States from 2012 to 2015 and aims to complement the PPMI. Here you see two links to each of these studies and the link to MGFF website. The goals of today's demo will be to explore browse and active filters use, cohort selection, basic statistics, grid view and expert, advanced workflows, smart R, genome browser. You're always welcome to ask questions during the presentation. We'll use PPMI and BioFind to repeat and visualize some published results and test hypotheses. And now we will proceed to the demonstration in Transmart. So once you are logged in, into Transmart, you will show you see the landing page of Transmart, which is Browse. Browse is an informational page. It contains the metadata on the studies available and supporting documentation. At the top of the Browse page, you see the main menu tabs of Transmart, which are except Browse, Analyze, Sample Explorer, Gene Signature List, GWAS, Upload Data, and Utilities right there. Utilities, I just wanted to say, contain help. Under this help, you will find the user guide for Transmart version 1.2 if you want to look through how to analyze data in details. You can contact us through email and other functions. The left pane of Browse contains active filters and Program Explorer. We have one program here under which, if you click the program node, you'll find BioFind and Parkinson's disease studies. Clicking on the name of each study, you'll see the brief description of the study, associated tags such as what is the study objective, the study link, how many subjects were participating in the study, the country where it carried on, and so on. Under that, you see study documents. Clicking on study documents, you see that BioFind has three PDF format documents that you can export on your computer, each one separately, or export them all. The same information will be for PPMI. If you want to analyze only one study at a time, you can open this study from here in Analyze View. So it's loading slowly. And here you see only PPMI that you can work on. Let's clear the filter and go back to Browse. The active filters allows you to find the category in the studies that you want to see is there. And you can use either all or browse through all and choose a category you want to look at. You can use filter with predefined categories, or you just can type in some category that you're looking for. Let's put a biomarker. Hit enter, and the two studies highlighted, which means biomarker present in any of these studies. If I put clinical assessments, hit enter, because I have biomarker here, it showed up, but if I remove biomarker, then we see that clinical assessments only available in PPMI study. Now let's navigate to Analyze. Analyze is a page that contains the, at the top of this page, you see the menu of the main tabs in Analyze. And each of these pages allows you to analyze data, export data, or retrieve your saved subsets. The right pane contains the subset definition boxes, save and clear panels. The left pane is a navigation tree to select studies and variables of interest. From there, you drag concepts from the notes and into the subset boxes to define cohorts. Now let's look through the study trees of PPMI and BioFind. So the study trees contain the major nodes that order the data into specific categories. They are pretty similar here because we always try to standardize the data. And PPMI contains such major subfolders as biomarkers, clinical assessments, enrollment, genetic data, imaging, medical history, patient status, and subjects. Under each of these main nodes, you will find the additional sub-nodes that also order the results further. Biomarker analysis contains the results of the all biomarkers analyzed in this study, while biospecimen contains additional information such as biospecimen inventory and laboratory procedures, if you want to look through that. Clinical assessments are ordered to motor and non-motor assessments, and under each subnode, you'll find a lot of questionnaires on behavioral questionnaires of patients with Parkinson's disease and healthy controls. Subjects contains the demographics information and additional subject characteristics such as family history, for example. So in the parentheses, at each node, you see the number of patients that have results in a category. PPMI has 1673 patients involved, but not all of them have results in every category here. Cohorts could be selected based on categorical, numerical, and expression data. You can select the whole node as a subset and proceed to the analysis, but some advanced workflow need two subsets to be created here that you will be able to run this analysis. If you put PPMI, if you put the whole node of the study here, you can export in data export the whole study files. Let's go a little bit into details. How do we create cohorts using numeric and high dimensional categories? Let's put some ETL score at baseline. As soon as you drag it in, you will be asked to set a value. You may want to use binumeric value. And it allows you to select operator where you cut off the group you're looking at Alif less than, you can look at the diagram, which will help you to choose the range that you want to cut off. And let's put 60% of the ideal score here. I click OK, and now we have this subset here. You can use include or exclude for creating subsets. And to look at how we do with high-dimensional data when creating cohorts, we'll drag in the whole node of high-dimensional data. And we have to search for term that we want to use. You can use just the list or type in the gen symbol that you want to look at. Let's put SNCA, which is alpha-synuclein, one of the biomarkers for signature biomarkers for Parkinson's disease. So it shows you histogram of the range of expression values for this gene. You can always use the upper and lower scroll bars to cut off and change the number of bins for your analysis. And definitely creating the two subsets allows us to compare two groups of interest. So in PPMI, we want to use usually Parkinson's disease as one group and healthy control to compare. Again, you can add anything, including or excluding, into the boxes below. The chosen subsets can be saved and later retrieved. So to save them, click Save. Give it a name. You can make its subset public seen by public. And it will be saved right away in workspace. And you see I created here a number of subsets for today's presentation. So you can delete anything that you don't need. Let's delete the test. And you can email any of this to your partners or colleagues. Let's go back to PPMI PD and healthy subjects. So now let's go to summary statistics. And summary statistics is basic statistics. It allows you to analyze and save data. By default, it gives you the summary statistics on age, sex, and race in the selected groups. And as you can see here, it gives you the numeric statistics as mean, median, standard deviation, and number of subjects involved, as well as it gives you the visual representation of this data by age histogram and box plot, plots for sex and race. And it also shows the percentage of the distribution in each of these categories. Now let's use summary statistics to repeat some published data. So this is a publication of 2015. And the authors of this publication used PPMI data, which was available from 2014, to find the correlates of excessive daytime sleepiness in de novo Parkinson's disease. They found that the mean ESS score, sleepiness score, was similar in PD subjects and healthy controls. 66 PD subjects, which is 15.6%, and 24 subjects, healthy control subjects, which is 12%, had ESS of at least 10. No difference was seen in demographic characteristics, age of onset, disease duration, PD subtype, cognitive status, or utilization oxidative between PD sleepiness positive versus the negative group. But the sleepiness positive group had higher MDS-EPDRS part 1 and part 2, but not part 3 scores. They also found that sleepiness was associated with a marginal reduction of A-beta, but not alpha-synuclein spinal fluid levels in PD subjects. The data in the paper is presented as tables, and you see here a lot of data. We'll see how we can reproduce quickly and visualize this some of this data in TransMart. So we already have here two groups that we created, PD subjects and healthy controls. And what we need to continue, just drag and drop from the study 3 node, the ESS, per sleepiness scale, summary score at baseline. So drag and drop it here, and right away we have the results that are this result correlates with the data published. I just show you how it correlates. So this is a published data, ESS in PD subjects and healthy controls, and that this is what we have in TransMart. So to continue with that, we can drag and drop the sleepiness baseline to see how many sleepy and non-sleepy patients are in each group. And the analysis gives us these results with that distribution. We have 65 sleepy PD patients and 24 non-sleepy patients, healthy controls, healthy controls, which also correlates with that published data. We can check for the sleepiness score here. If these sleepy patients have the scores more than 10. Just to check and to show you how we can easily retrieve our saved groups from backspace. So I created these two subsets. We go to summary statistics. It's loading. And we see that 65 PD patients and 24 healthy controls have the sleepiness score more than 10, which is exactly what the authors of the publication found. Let's compare the PD subjects with who are positive and negative with their sleepiness. So again, we're going to workspace and choose the group PD sleepy versus non-sleepy, right here. Go to summary statistics. Browse the motor assessments for MDS-EPDRS. Here we have the part one summary score. That score here. And the results of the analysis are here, and we see the significant difference between the scores in sleepy and non-sleepy PD subjects. The p-values are shown under the analysis bar. You can always save results from summary statistics while you're running using this print at the right upper corner, and you can save it in the PDF format on your computer using, for example, BALZIP PDF printer or a similar program. Let's navigate to grid view. So once you created subsets and played in summary statistics, dragging and drop into the sum categories, you have this same list of the data in the grid view. The grid view allows you to create the lists of data. It also allows you to drag and drop additional data into it. Let's put some more scores here. And it's very useful when you want to quickly look through the data in some categories. Using the top filter bar, you can remove from here some columns that you don't need, for example, default ones, leaving only what you want to look at. Could be trial, because we know that it is PPMI subjects. You can always return them back. You can also filter sorting, ascending or descending the data if you want to look at them. So it will sort categorical and numeric data as well. So once you created this list, you can export it to Excel. At the bottom, you see the export to Excel button here, and use it to analyze it on your computer. Click that button, and right away you have that file on downloaded onto your computer. There is another way to export data from Transmart using Data Export. So Data Export page will allow you to export data which is already in grid view. Or if you, as I said before, if you put the whole study node as a subset, it will show you all the data in the study that you can download. It allows you to download separately clinical or low dimensional data in each subset, or genomic variant data, which is available in PPMI. Once you decided what you want to export, you click Export Data button at the bottom, and you can run it in background while you can proceed with the analysis you want to run. You can always go to export jobs and see the export status. This one is gathering data. Once it will be completed, you click on the name and the data will be downloaded on your computer as a zip folder. At this point, maybe somebody have any questions?
Yeah, we did have one question come in so far. The question was, is it possible to give more descriptive names to, for example, you had subset one and subset two?
The descriptive names in the saved subsets that you...
Yes, I guess so.
At the moment, you can only have here the subsets namings. So that's what Transmart allows you, unfortunately. Okay. Yeah.
Did that answer your question, Brad?
But you always have here the description of what is that subset. You know, there is boxes here that show you which subset you have. So subset one here is Parkinson's disease, and it says core sleeping is baseline sleeping, here non-sleeping. See, so there is a description here of the subsets. But they will not appear here. Did I answer your question?
Let's see if we get another question, but so far, yes.
Okay. Let's go further. And as it was found, sleepiness was associated with a reduction of A beta in PD subjects. So at this point, I want to move to SMART-R and do a comparison of Parkinson's disease subjects who are sleepy and non-sleepy. So we will visualize the results using boxplot workflow. And
Elena, sorry, we do have another question from Ivan Moser. I'll unmute you.
Okay.
Ivan, do you want to ask a question? Ivan, I've unmuted you.
No other question, thank you.
Oh, okay, your hand is raised, great.
Sorry, it was a mistake.
Okay. All right, sorry, go ahead. Elena, keep going.
Okay. So we already have these two subsets of PD subjects, and we will just go to biomarkers and find the A-beta in CSF at baseline. We just need to drag and drop it into numerical values, click fetch data, and run analysis as it will be ready. You can choose raw values or logarithmic. Click create plot, and here we have the results. At the top, you see the p-values, and it's an interactive, SmartR is an interactive interface, and browsing through the boxes, you can see the statistics results. You can save this plot as PNG format. You can save and edit plot in cloud. You can zoom in and zoom out that plot if you want to. Let's use another publication from 2016, where the authors found that APOE4 genotype was associated with lower levels of A-beta in healthy controls and PD subjects, but not alpha-synuclein. So to run that in Transmart, we can use also box plot, which we can do in advanced workflows as well. Some of the analyses in advanced workflow have the same analysis in SmartR. So we just use only one subset, Parkinson's disease patients, and in the advanced workflow boxes, we put E4 positive and E4 negative as independent variable and baseline levels of alpha-synuclein as dependent variable. And after hitting run analysis, you will get this box plot and the statistical values for alpha-synuclein. The same we can do for A-beta, and you see that the data is significantly different for A-beta as the authors of the publication concluded. So we can also run line graph in advanced workflow with the same E4 genotype positive versus A-beta, and look at the timeline change of A-beta in these two groups. So you see that the level of A-beta was lower in patients with E4 positive genotype here. So the same authors found that there is a correlation between the levels of CSF alpha-synuclein and A-beta tau, p-tau in healthy controls and PD subjects. We can reproduce the data using advanced workflow correlation analysis. We go to advanced workflow. I need to remove here sleepy, non-sleepy, clear this panel, leaving only one subset for that. Go to correlation analysis. And let's drag and drop here baseline A-beta and baseline alpha-synuclein. You can use correlation type. Hit run. And the data is shown below. We can run the same analysis in SmartR using also correlation workflow, the same approach, drag and drop the data, fetch data, okay, not match the requirement. Transmart is always tells you if you're doing something wrong. So I put the numeric data into categorical box. Fetch data and run analysis again, choosing, let's choose Spearman also. And we see we have the same results, but this plot is interactive. You can go through the individual data for each patient, looking at the dots and look at the intercept and slope right here in this window. Now let's try to do to paid hypothesis. So the paper published in 2017 on the different cohorts of PD patients and controls found that plasma levels of alpha-synuclein were significantly high in patients with PD compared with controls. It was also found that there is a significant increase in plasma alpha-synuclein levels in PD patients with a higher Hoyer and Yar stage. So let's see if we can get something similar using the alpha-synuclein in CSF. And for that, we can run the line graph in SmartR. So again, here, for this analysis, we want to use healthy controls and PD subjects and see how convenient it is to have this saved subsets. So we'll put baseline values of alpha-synuclein into numeric variable and put the month 6 and month 12. Fetch data. And run analysis. You can always save the data from this analysis by capture SVG. Once you click it, it will be saved on your computer. So this is again an interactive plot, and you can choose different statistical categories. When you look at mean with SAM, looks much better. But definitely it's your choice what you're going to use. And here you can click on each line to see the available data. So next, we wanted to look at the Fisher test in advanced workflow to see if there will be a difference between the different stages of Hoyer and Yar questionnaire.
We did have one question.
Yep.
In the question window, we were asked, is it possible to supplement update a data set that is already available in Transmart? For example, I have an ongoing study, but I put in some data from my pilot study. As the data is generated, can I update that study with the new data?
Well, you can update your study with the data, but the data should be curated. So,
sure.
Yeah, so definitely anything can be added into the studies. And that's what we have now. The new PPMI study is coming, and we're going to update it soon and put the new set so that will contain the data which we have now and additional data.
Okay.
You can also add new studies here.
Yeah, he's asking how we do that. I think that might be out of scope of what we can go into much detail here. Is there anything easy you can say? How do you do the update?
Well, we do updates if were asked to, and if we provided this data, so Rancho Biosciences do these updates. I'm not sure how and who can do it. Maybe some other groups can help with that. But definitely, for that, you need to have an ETL engineer who will load the data into Transmart and people who will curate the data. So Rancho Biosciences provides that.
Okay.
Did I answer the question?
Yeah. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. That's all I can say at this point.
Okay.
So can we go better?
Yes.
Okay. So I wanted to show the table with Fisher test where we can analyze the level of alpha-synuclein versus the wear and tear stage in patients with Parkinson's disease. I have to clear the subset 2 because we need only subset 1 here. And we'll go to part 3, EPDRS test. Find the core and PR stage baseline. And we can drag and drop the whole node here. For the numeric data as a dependent variable, you need to do binning. So we'll click enable binning and click bin the independent variable. We can leave number of bins as 2 or do manual binning, specifying which range of score of alpha synuclein you want to have here. I will leave it as it is for now. And you see the results here, which are tables. And we see only stage 1, stage 2, and stage 3, which means these patients with PD that we chose for comparison with the alpha-synuclein had only these 3 stages. So the other thing I wanted to go through is the linear regression. A scatter plot with linear regression analysis. And there is another publication that authors found that high levels of alpha-synuclein with the PD group, within the PD group, were associated with progression of motor symptoms and cognitive decline over 2 years. So in PPMI, we don't have the data for biomarkers for 2 years, but we have only one year data for this analysis, and we'll use that to see if there any difference, and also to explore scatterplot with linear regression. So again, we'll use the PD subjects only, and we'll put here the month 12. Alpha-synuclein. Let's put p-tau, month 12, will be dependent variable, and the part 3 EPDRS score will be our independent variable. We can do a logarithmic transformation here, hit-run. And once it completed running, we have a scatter plot here. So we don't see the significant difference here, probably because, oh, sorry, I put baseline here. See, this is my mistake. I had to put month 12, hit run. And we see the p-value is lower, but still not significant. So the next, we're going to move to BioFind and do some tests with the high-dimensional data, which is available in BioFind. So here I have to clear all panels because we're moving to other studies. Study and selecting the groups for the study, healthy and PD subjects. We go to advanced workflow and let's do marker selection. So we drag and drop the whole node here. I will reduce number of markers here to 10 because this analysis may take some time to run. Calculate the score on the fly. It will calculate separately the scores for both subsets. And while it's running, I will show you the results that I prepared before. So this is a heat map. You see Parkinson's disease healthy control subsets here on the top. On the side, you see the probe names. At the bottom, the subject's ID. And at the bottom of the heat map, you see the table of top markers. So just to mention, this project was created for identification of RNA biomarkers for idiopathic Parkinson's disease in blood. And the RNA-seq was run at the custom-made platform. So that's why you may not see many known gen symbols in the list of probes there. Some of them are just RNAs. I wanted to use the marker selection and create a gene signature list, putting a few of these gene symbols in the Excel file. And I added some biomarker signature genes for Parkinson's disease here as well. I saved this in text format and then loaded it into Transmart to make it to use it in creating heat map and some other analysis. So once you have the gene signature, you can run the heat map, putting the whole node into the box and clicking the high dimensional data where you will choose your file that was downloaded with gene signatures. And here you can see it. After that, you hit run. And now you see the smaller heat map with the chosen in our list genes here. You can run the hierarchical clustering with gene signature as well. And this method builds the hierarchy of clusters with similar expression profiles. And data is organized with a clustering tree on the top of the heat map, as you see here. And heat map can also be built in Smart R. I decided to make a heat map with Parkinson's disease patients who are REM sleep positive and negative. And I wanted to mention here that sometimes it's very important to avoid errors due to the absence of subjects in the selected cohorts to check if they present in the cohorts. So for that, I created the subsets where I did edit the genetic data into the subsets and ran the summary statistics. So once I see that there is 14 patients and 16 patients in each subset, I can proceed to heat map. If it will not be enough patients or if there will not be patients in one of these groups, the heat map will show you error. So let's stop this analysis because it's still running. Sometimes it takes time. And let's go to Smart R. Go to heat map workflow. Drag And let's check what we have here. We have healthy controls. Yeah, we wanted to use Parkinson's disease patients. We can do it here, actually, or we can do it in SmartR because it allows us to choose categories here. Let's do that. So I add high dimensional data here. Go to assessments and choose category values. The heat map workflow in SmartR allows to select biomarkers here without creating gene signature. Let's put some genes here. It's NCA, for example, PINK1. These are signature genes for Parkinson's, NARC2. And hit fetch the data. So once the data is fetched, you see the summary of fetched data at the bottom. You can go to pre-process and aggregate probes. We're not going to do that right now. And then you can run analysis, but before you can define parameters for this analysis, you can change for mean, for example, and hit create plot. As you see, you always can download this heat map on your computer. So this is how the heat map in SmartR looks like. It has statistics here at the bottom, the cohorts, positive and negative. You can do the clustering analysis right here in this heat map by selecting a type of clustering. And you see the hierarchy of clusters, three at the top and on the side of the heat map. You can choose any of these if you like to. So this is a pretty nice and interactive interface in SmartR. Another analysis that I wanted to show you in SmartR, which is available now, is a Volcano workflow. Volcano workflow is actually the type of biomarker selection. So that's why we'll create healthy and Parkinson's disease groups and drag the dimensional data here, fetch the data. Volcano plot may also take some time to run. That's why I created the results here. This is how the default results will look like. And on the side, you see the table with top markers in the range of p-values defined by default and logarithm. So you can change the cutoffs, adjusting the sliders, you move them. And you see that the long table became shorter at this range. And here there are some biomarkers that we found already in the biomarker analysis of the advanced workflow. See, it's still running. That's why we'll stop it, because I already showed you results, and proceed to Genome Browser. We're going back to PPMI, here all the panels here, because PPMI contains the data from BCF files in the folder genetic data. So exome sequencing data by chromosomes or a gene sequencing data in the or SNP data can be used for browsing in genome browser. Genome browser allows also to use to compare two subsets. So it's always useful to reset the browser before you will drag the high-dimensional node here, and we'll use SNP data to look at it. Before that, we will create cohorts. So I wanted to create a cohort based on genotyping of selected SNPs. And let's look at these two groups of with LARC mutation G2019S, positive or negative. So we'll use this one as a subset one, and this one is a subset two. Go to genome browser, and now we can drag the folder with SNPs. Hit OK. And we see that the data for subset one and subset two, this data here, are loaded. You have two options here to choose the region of interest. You can put the region if you know what it is, or just put the gene of interest that you want to look at. Let's put L LARC. Hit enter. And it will show you all the SNPs available for LARC2 in genome browser. So here you have several variables available to browse: quality of depth, summary of minor allele frequency, and variants, and also minor allele frequency as well. So it's loading. Maybe you have some questions at this point.
We did have one question back in the linear regression analysis. Brad is asking, is it possible to analyze the change in scores? For example, maybe create a new variable, which is the difference between the 12-month data minus the baseline?
Absolutely. Absolutely, you can do that, yes. Unfortunately, we don't have that in PPMI at the moment, but actually we're planning to add some of the variables that allow that. So it's almost finished loading here, and subset one is already here. So if I click one of these crosses, which are SNPs. Maybe it's, yeah. I see the information on the SNP in this table, in this box. And we see that this is exactly the same RS34637584 variant. The reference nucleotide is G. It changed to A here, which is what we expected. And the allele count is six. We have six patients in this group with total allele 12, and allele frequency is 0.5. So you can browse through any of this data and look in each and compare them in each subsets. And finally, I wanted to tell you, which is very exciting, that now Transmart NeuroShare has the API connection, which you can use to connect Transmart data to your R if you want to analyze the data from PPMI or BioFind on your computer in R. You just run these R packages to install the connection. And just to note, once you will have to run the connect to Transmart, you have to put the proper URI of the Transmart instance. This is my address, and each user is assigned to their own Transmart container. So be sure that you put the address properly. Once you run the connect to Transmart, you'll be asked to refresh, to put the token. For that, you'll have to copy and paste this URI into the web browser, click enter, and you'll get a token which you place here in the console. Click enter, and here you are, you will be connected to Transmart. And you can select the categories in your R that you want to analyze. So basically, this is all that I wanted to tell you today. Thank you for your attention, and maybe there will be some more questions at the end.
Yeah, if anyone has a question, you can type it into the the question panel, or if you want to raise your hand, I can unmute you. Not seeing any questions so far, but I'll hear something. Is there a variable which indicates the site, for example, like Australia or Israel or US?
Let's look. So actually, PPMI doesn't have that at the moment, no. But when loading data to Transmart, we always ask what our customers want us to load there. So if the data is available, we can do that. We can always add the site. Like in other studies, we do have the sites where the study was performed, but not in PPMI.
Okay, and what about the exact date of a particular visit?
The exact date of particular visit. Let's go there. We have some dates here in this. Some dates, but I'm not sure if we have the particular visit date. So consent and enrollment. Yeah, there is an enrollment date here, but it's not connected to the, yeah. We don't have the dates of each visit. Yeah, we have some dates, but not that particular. But this also can be added as well.
Okay.
So if the data allows, we can add anything. We can calculate some scores if needed, or the duration. For example, PPMI at the moment do not have the duration between onset and Parkinson's disease diagnosis, but we can calculate that and put it there.
Okay. And also, is there any variable that indicates if the patient died or if was lost, you know, or left the study or something?
Yes, there is data where in enrollment. It's, let's see, signed consent. For example, signed consent shows if patient declined or was excluded. There is reason for declining, reason for exclusion. Have a reference source here. There is in inpatient status. We also have some information about enrollment status. So
okay.
Here you can see that information right here.
Good. Okay. All right. I don't see any other questions. So I want to thank you very much, Elena. It's very, very good presentation again. And I just want to mention one thing. The question came up about the R interface. And actually, in November, we do have Clarivate Analytics will be given a session on cross-study analysis using the R interface. And you will be able to get to see the R interface in action at that time. So again, thank you very much. And we will, this will be recorded, and the recording will be available within a couple of days this week. So thanks everyone for joining us, and consider coming to another training class in the future. Thanks everyone.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.